Hello and welcome to another episode of the Digital Health and Wearables series. Before we go ahead, I would like to acknowledge our global partners, Spirit Digital, please check them out, and our other innovator supporters. But today we have a very interesting episode for you, so let me introduce you to Vanessa Carter, which is a patient advocate for antimicrobial resistance. Vanessa, how are you?
Hi, Joe. Fine, and you?
And nice to see you.
Yeah, great to see you too. Thank you for the opportunity.
No, that's brilliant. And now you are in UK, and it feels such a long time since we met in France. We were talking the other day. It was back in 2015, wasn't it?
Yes. Time flies. It was 6 years ago at Doctors 2.0 and you.
Yeah, fantastic. So, yeah, I have a couple of questions for you. The work that you do, by the way, is very, very interesting. I hope we get a good viewer from Farm and different organizations that are interested in you and the work and the expertise that you bring. But the first question that I have, Vanessa, is can you explain what is antibiotic resistance and your own experience, please?
Sure, yes. So let me start with my experience first. When I was 25, I had a car accident in Johannesburg in South Africa. And, I did a lot of damage to my face and my internal organs. I was put on life support. I was resuscitated. It was a very severe accident. And when I recovered, I was in the public health system at the time. When I left the hospital, Johannesburg Hospital, I was left with the major task of reconstructing my face, which was the most difficult part of it all. I had a broken nose, I had a broken jaw, had broken cheekbones, lost the right eye. 25 years old, that's a massive thing because you don't know any age, you don't know where to start. Mm-hmm. So I went from doctor to doctor, different experts, different super specialists to try and understand what I needed to do, because it needed different types of experts. So, for example, ophthalmologist and a neurosurgeon and a plastic surgeon and a plastic microsurgeon and a craniofacial surgeon, all these names I'd never heard of before. I had a couple of prosthetics implanted until my sixth year, when I had a cheek implant put in, to sort of call it, very plainly, became infected. I always explain it exactly the same way. I went to the store one day, I went to the shop, I came out, I got into my car, and I felt this fluid on my face. So I pulled down the rear view mirror and there was just pus seeping out. It was really scary. And this was about 3 weeks after the implant and some touch-up surgeries had been done on it. So I called my doctor's offices and he said, okay, it's an infection, go to emergency, let's, have a look at it. And from that day forward, for the next 11 months, I was in and out of hospital doing debridement surgeries and tissue reconstruction surgeries. And I was getting different opinions from my different experts of where this infection was and how to deal with it. And of course, being prescribed antibiotics at the same time by all of them. Even, of course, during the surgery as well. But the issue was that the infection wasn't going away. In fact, it was getting worse. And eventually, in the 11th month, I was with my ENT surgeon. He had to do a second sinus drainage because they were trying to see if they could, drain the sinuses to get rid of this infection. Maybe it was coming from there. And my plastic surgeon, who by then I'd built up quite a really good relationship with, sat me down and said, you need to take this cheek implant out, because if you don't, I know that you're getting different opinions, but you need to take it out because that is where the infection is and it's not going to go away until you remove it. And I kind of argued back with him because I had these other doctors telling me that it could stay. And he happened to be in the surgery next door while the ENT surgeon was doing the surgery. And without my permission during the surgery, he took the risk. He came in and he took the implant out. So when I woke up, I was only expecting ENT surgery to be done, but this implant had been removed. And that was the first time that my alarm bells rang, because I thought, why did he? I could sue him. I could take him, you know, medical legal case straight there, because nobody signed consent to take this implant out. And so I knew then that he had sent this implant away for testing to the what we call Lancet laboratories in South Africa. So I phoned them and I said to them, you know, can I please have a copy of my test? And when they faxed it through to me, or emailed it through to me, it's at the top, you know, it said MRSA. I was like, what is MRSA? This was all new to me. And when I started Googling it, antibiotic resistance is what I had. And it stressed me out completely, because not once during my journey had I been told that. Not once during my journey had I been explained the risks of antibiotic resistance. And so I think that's kind of what got me, you know, interested in the advocacy side of things, because it shouldn't be that way. So antibiotic resistance, now to answer your second part of the question. Antibiotic resistance is when an antibiotic class that you are taking, and it might not be, you know, so for example, in my case, it was the penicillin class or the methicillin class that I became resistant to. There were actually a couple of antibiotics that I had been resistant to by that point in time, but not the very end of the line ones, like colistin and vancomycin, which they had to give to me to eventually clear the infection. But I also had to play a very large role in infection control, you know, and adhering to my antibiotics very carefully, which I wasn't doing up to that point, because I had no idea what the problem was.
Well, it is such a complex, interesting area in a way, but such a complexity. And it seems like you've been on a journey and you come a long way and you learn a lot and you have your own experience, which is so valuable, because this is it's not really a subject that we often common talk about. We talk about other things in healthcare, but this is such an, I learn a lot. So thank you for sharing that, Vanessa. The other question that I have for you moving on is, how communication between doctors, clinicians, be improved and reduce gaps with patients?
You know, I think, and I'll fall back on my own experience again, because I'm not a qualified, you know, physician. But you know, I think that one way to do that would be through literally sitting the patient down and talking to them and explaining what the risks are of taking antibiotics. I think that's missing in healthcare. You know, and well, it was in South Africa. I'm yet to see it in the UK to make that comparison. And of course, communicating between each other. You know, doctors, when they prescribe antibiotics. So let me quickly raise this for your viewers. The overuse of antibiotics is one of the things that contributes towards antibiotic resistance. So when you are, in my case, I was prescribed the same type of antibiotic by all my doctors. They weren't communicating with each other about you know, the type of antibiotics I was taking. So, you know, I might have got a question from a doctor saying, when was the last time you were on antibiotics? And I'd say, well, a week and a half ago. They don't ask you what type of antibiotic it was. There's no central information. There's no, you know, where each doctor can look at your, for example, electronic health record and say, well, you know, this doctor prescribed, you know, amoxicillin for this patient last week, and it doesn't seem to be working. I can see that on an electronic health record, or, you know, patient engagement platform, whatever you want to call it, communication platform. So I'm not going to prescribe it then, and I'm actually going to raise a red flag here, because this might be antibiotic resistance. So you know, I saw it with my own eyes. Doctors, you know, when we talk about communication, doctors don't have time to sit and phone each other about a patient case. They don't. They don't have time. I had six or seven doctors. They didn't. To try and coordinate that meeting was impossible. So I think digital health has a big role, has a very large role in enabling that type of environment. And as I say, I think one of the biggest things would be recording what each doctor is prescribing to a patient. That is very visible to whoever that patient goes to that is treating them.
Brilliant. Vanessa, you raised such an important issue in there about the lack of communication. Also, you touched on centralized data. I mean, in UK, for example, the systems are very fragmented, different organizations, for example, even different hospitals, they have different solutions, different providers. I mean, it's very complex. And you mentioned that digital health will be like the solution patch that to bring it all together. But thank you for sharing that. It's really, it's a common issue in digital health. And also you mentioned another thing very important, that the doctors don't actually have the time to go through, for example, past records, previous experiences and information from other doctors, because, for example, they have 5 or 10 minutes with the patient. They need to do what they need to do on the spot at the moment, see what they have. They don't really have the time to go and do half an hour research about the patient that is coming in next, because they're overwhelmed with patients. So it is a bit of a catch-22, isn't it? But interesting. The last question that I have for you that is touching on digital health is, what's the role of digital technologies in bringing patients closer to their treatments and their own health?
Okay, so I'll stick to what I know, and that's AMR, which is, I mean, it touches on most diseases anyway. I think that one of the first things that it can do is help patients to adhere to their medications, especially antimicrobial medications like antibiotics, better. If I just sort of put myself in or explain a certain situation that I was in at one stage, where I was taking antibiotics at different times. I was taking them, you know, I was thinking if I take 2 in the morning, it made up for that one that I missed in the afternoon kind of thing. But I think that digital technologies could help us understand why taking antibiotics at certain equal intervals is important. Using things like education that are tailored to the patient. So, for example, I might be deaf, I might not be able to speak English, I might have a mental health illness. My son is autism, so there's a good example of that. Using videos or using audio or whatever to explain why adherence is so important. So an example of that would be an app. You know, when you go and you collect your antibiotics, why can't we download a mobile application that helps us, guides us to take our antibiotics more carefully? Because again, going back to the doctor doesn't have time. The pharmacist is now being included more in the clinician, clinician-patient interaction kind of thing when it comes to antimicrobial stewardship. But technology can help to fill that gap. They can help to fill that gap to empower patients, to say to them, how are your symptoms today? Because your doctor doesn't have time to do that. They're only with you 10% of the time, right? So how are your symptoms today? Let's track it for you. Oh, the infection's getting worse. Let's report it to the doctor. So these are things that we're not exploring these technologies enough. And of course, I mentioned EHR early on, electronic health records. Another thing that's really, really important when it comes to antimicrobial resistance, and COVID-19 is a very good example of that in terms of communicable diseases, is we need to start looking at globalizing this technology, globalizing this data. In my case, with having a car accident, just alone with the car accident, this isn't counting all the other times I've been ill in my life, I had a 600-page file of medical reports, of things, of complications and things that were recorded that could go wrong. I walked into some of my doctor's offices sometimes and, I used to put it on their desk and say, you really need to read this because I'm supposed to give you this information as a patient. This is my responsibility to provide all the information. But at this point in time, as patients, we aren't doing that. Why? Because we're not going to, it's a telephone directory. What time does our doctor have to read their telephone directory? And this is why things like AI and technology are so important.
Fantastic. Vanessa, that's in such important things, the gaps there, but also the education side, the personalization about what you mentioned around digital technologies. As you know, you also work in the field of digital health. I mean, pharma companies are developing apps for different conditions. I mean, big players are creating solutions around that, but it's certainly an area to be developed. And also, we talked about last week before planning this interview about the co-creation side. I mean, someone like you would be pivotal and so crucial to make these organizations understand what is important from the other side, from the patient side. So co-creation now is a big word, but doesn't always happen in reality, as you know, anyway. But it's a brilliant conversation. We could explore the topics and everything. Vanessa, one last little thing, which is not really a question as such to round up our interview. It's been magnificent. I learned a lot, and there's so much to think and consider. I finish all my episodes with 1 minute of fame. Okay, it's not a question as such, but anything that you can mention, it can be a shout out, it can be a personal achievement, it can be a professional thing, it can be anyone in a family, anything that you really want. So over to you.
1 minute of?
1 minute of fame. I call it 1 minute of fame. You can mention anything that you want. It can be a professional achievement, a personal achievement, mention someone else, anything that you want. I mean, anything whatsoever.
Okay. I've achieved a lot, but I don't want to. I don't talk much about it. I guess one of the biggest things. Okay, let me end like this. One of the biggest things with antimicrobial resistance is, like I said, it's global. Coming from an African background. Coming from a South African background, we tend to leave out the LMRCs. And we're seeing this now with the vaccines, the vaccine programs that are going on. So I'm really excited. I'm really thrilled to be part of that. And I never, ever claim to be a patient voice for everybody, because it's such a very complex problem that I talk about. Maybe it's just to kind of send out a message to say, you know, spend more time, think very hard about the way COVID spread across borders. AMR can do exactly the same thing. So I hope that's okay. Yeah,
that's brilliant. Vanessa, I want to thank you for your time. We met a long time ago. I really appreciate the work that you do, and more people need to know about you and how you can really add value to organizations. I want to thank our viewers. Very interesting subject. I'm going to include in all the editings the description of the video, Vanessa's contacts. Please connect with Vanessa. And that leads me to thank you again. Thank you to all the viewers. And if you have not subscribed, please do so. And I'll see you next time. Vanessa, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much, Joe.
See you next time. Thank you.